All right. So today I'm sitting down with Brian Bogaert. He is the founder of Next Level Success, advising people on how to build wealth through strategic and intelligent investments. He is known as the guy who can simplify money and show you how to become financially free step by step. Brian is passionate about creating freedom and wealth for himself and others from a place of choosing powerfully and living your freedom life now. Welcome, Brian, to the Body Project Podcast.
Hello, Catherine. How are you? I'm so excited and happy to be here today.
I am happy you are joining us. So, to give you a little bit of context, Brian, for the last 2 years, the Body Project Podcast has been a fitness podcast that I interview fitness and movement professionals on how fitness is a powerful access point to transforming all areas of their lives. But in the midst of the global pandemic, I shifted the conversation to meet the needs of my listeners, to make sure that they feel supported with the tools to better manage their overwhelm, to better manage their fear and anxiety. Anxiety around this unprecedented time. And so I thought that this conversation was a really important one. With unemployment rates escalating daily and the Canadian government pumping money into our hands more than ever on record, there is a lot of tension around how can people sustain their day-to-day living, right? Like feeding their families, paying their rent and their bill, let alone looking at the deficit of the country hereafter, right? So I believe that, I wanted to bring you on not only just from a small business conversation, because small businesses are, the foundation of our economy, right? But also, how can you speak from your wheelhouse, being the coach, the consultant, the advisor in the financial space to support people where they are today?
I'm so glad you're asking this and sharing this with your typical viewers who are normally tuning in to talk to you about health and fitness and that kind of thing, because it's so absolutely on people's minds right now. I like to say that, yes, we're in a global health pandemic, but the reality is we're way more people are being affected by this global financial pandemic, right? I know a handful of people who them or a loved one is suffering from COVID-19. I know thousands of people who are suffering from this financial trauma that we find ourselves in right now. So it's so utterly important. And exactly what you described, right? When this hit, I had programs that I was about to launch, things that I was focused on. And for about a week, I was like, well, what should I do here? What's going on? Like, this isn't what people need to be hearing about right now. This isn't what I should be talking about. And I made a very similar kind of pivot that you're discussing on, like, what do people need to be talking about right now? What are some of those things that are on their mind? And honestly, one of the number one things that if people aren't already doing it, that they need to start looking at right now is cash flow. Whether you are an entrepreneur or you have a regular 9-to-5 job or and whatever stage you're in, if you weren't on top of cash flow before COVID-19 hit, then you absolutely need to sit down and look at that. Now, of
Okay,
course,
so
the thing about that is it's an intimidating, it's hard for people. They're already suffering from stress and anxiety and uncertainty. And now I'm like, hey, look at your finances, right? I get it. I absolutely get it. What were you going to ask me, Kevin?
yeah, so let's break that down for people. What does that mean when you say cash flow? Is that money in the bank? Is it separate from saving? Is it what we kind of have as like that transaction day to day? What do you mean exactly by that?
So, I mean, you break it right at cash flow, right? So what money is coming in to my world, my universe? Some of us, if you're just getting a paycheck and it's going directly into your personal checking account, then it's pretty easy. But some of us that have businesses and multiple sources of income, it might be a little bit more complex. But every single person should have a handle on how much money comes in every month and then what's going out. What are my expenses? Right now, listen, a lot of people are like, oh, great, he's gonna send me a spreadsheet. I'm not really even a spreadsheet guy. Okay, so what that looks like for me, and I've been doing this practice for years, and it's one of the first things that I'll tell to my new clients is you should be going into your online bank account, whether that's on your phone or on your laptop or whatever. You should be going in pretty much every day, especially if this is a new practice for you. and just look at what's going on. Oh, look, I have an insurance payment that comes out around the end of the month almost every single time. Oh, my mortgage payment always comes out around the 13th. Oh, okay. Oh, I have that car payment that comes out around the first week of the month. And just really start to get a handle on that. I don't have my expenses listed in a spreadsheet somewhere, but I can tell you the day of the month, the amount, and what it looks like. And credit cards is another thing. The company sends you an itemized list of how of what your expenses are on your credit card every month, or you know, your debit card. You have to be looking at that. I know relatively how much my amount is going to be on my credit card every month. So if one month I'm like, whoa, what the heck? This is way bigger than usual. It's a trigger to me to be looking at this, to be paying attention of it. I'm not like these TV shows where it's like, you must have a budget and follow this down to the penny and be tracking this, and I'm going to smack you, you know, if you're not. It's about financial awareness. And right now, I mean, always, but especially right now in something like a pandemic, you have to be aware of that cash flow. And then you can start looking at what are the next few months going to be like? How much money can I expect to be coming in? And what are my fixed expenses that are going to be going out? Then you can start to create a plan. You can start to look for the deficit. Oh, I'm going to be down by $1,000 a month. Or, hey, listen, we haven't been going out to eat for the past 2 months, so our expenses have actually stayed pretty static. We're okay. You can only do that when you start to get this awareness of your cash flow, your expenses versus the money you've got coming in.
Thank you for that. And the way that you frame that actually makes it much more palatable for me also. I'm definitely not a spreadsheet person. That's my probably the weakest part of my business is to look at the finance. So that makes a lot of sense that it can be simply looking at the transactions that are coming out of our bank account, taking an accounting literally of our Visa bills, and then really understanding what we need to know. So I love that. That's great.
Yeah. And so, and again, this is all kept for you, right? In your in your bank account, you can see the last 6 months. That's my dog's tail, by the way. If you know, with your credit card, they are sending you these statements. It's very easy for you to see what did it look like pre-COVID, and then what's it been like over the last couple of months. Then you can start to make projections of what are the next few months going to look like. And I know, especially for entrepreneurs, it's like, I have no idea how much money is going to be coming in over the next few months, right? That's the uncertainty that everybody is grappling with. But first, just start with, what are my fixed expenses? What are the things I know I have to pay for? One of my clients literally spent the morning calling the different companies and finding out, like, can she get a break on her cell phone? What's the break going to be for her electricity? When are her property taxes due? She could only do that by first getting that snapshot of what are my expenses, and then look for the mitigation strategies of how she's going to cover that.
Great. No, that's such a great tip. So Brian has been joining me for almost a month now inside my Body Project online studio. And this studio online was really born out of that shift that I needed to make, right? I literally, like so many people, had to close my door because of the pandemic, right? And I know, so I shifted it online, but I know so many people had to shut their doors, right? So many people that I've interviewed on the podcast, a lot of people in my fitness community. And one of the challenges is, and why fitness studios are closing their doors, is that because they don't have a runway ahead of them, right? And so I know this conversation isn't really about how do we save in this time, but what do we need to know, you know, looking forward, and what strategies can we put in place now? Because I really believe that it's in the practice of how we find balance, right? I speak to my clients about the balance and the practices for our fitness and our nutrition and mindset. But what practices can we adopt during this time, Brian, to make us more financially stable coming out of COVID, and then that'll reinforce the practices hereafter?
So beautiful, beautiful questions, Catherine. So here's one of the first things is stop watching the news, okay? Stop tuning into that stuff and looking at the doom and gloom. The headlines are ridiculous to me. Like, I look at them and they're, you know, like, Toronto real estate industry tanking. And then you read it and it's like, prices have stayed the same from a year ago.
Yes.
So how is that tanking, right? There's so much ridiculous information on the news and scare and fear tactics and all that. So that'd be the first thing I would say to people is stop watching the news, who cares what the government is doing if it's not directly impacting you? And people say to me all the time, well, how do you live without knowing the news? People tell me what I need to know. I don't have to be glued to the TV set. People are always, my mom will be like, did you see what was on the news? Right. So I'm going to get the information. I don't need to be sitting there watching it.
Right.
But here's the thing. And I'm very lucky in some of the communities that I'm in and the people that I work with, you know, I'm wearing my t-shirt today about free your mind. Okay. So this is about mindset. And this is so important to me. And as a wealth coach, one of the first things I work on with people is your mindset. Yes, all the tactics and strategies and all that are wonderful, but honest to goodness, it starts with your mindset. And here's what I know about times of crisis. Fortunes are made as well as lost in times of crisis. Okay. As many millionaires and billionaires come out of times of crisis as people who go bankrupt. This is actually a period of opportunity. And one of the first things that I was talking about after I kind of got my own head on straight was, how do we go from surviving to thriving? And that's a mindset that I want to talk to people about. Now, if you're ill right now, or you're dealing with someone who's ill, or you're trying to get government program just to be able to feed your family, then this message might not be landing. And I get it. I completely understand. And you have to take care of those priority items first, which is why we talked about that cash flow first. But once you have a handle on that sort of stuff, the next thing is to start looking for, well, where is the actual opportunity in this? And I wanted to use you, Catherine, as an example of that today. Like, you so brilliantly and eloquently just pivoted in a moment of like, can't run my day-to-day studio, physical studio. What can I do? Boom. And you were online doing workouts with people. That is what surviving to thriving looks like. That's what happens when you go, how can I create an opportunity here? Maybe you'll never go back to a physical studio again, or maybe you'll have a balance of the two. Mm-hmm. That's what everybody has potentially in front of them right now. I've heard stories of restaurants suddenly going into the delivery business and other people going, what do I have? People are baking bread and muffins and selling them to their neighbors who don't want to go grocery shopping, right? I mean, that's a small example. But right now there's an explosion of online businesses. And coming out of this, what's the number one thing that we're all going to be craving and crazy about coming out of this? Well, we just saw it in the example of everybody flocking to the park. People want connection, right? So what could you do that could potentially be revenue generating for helping people create more connection in their lives as we start to come out of this? Look for the opportunities. As myself, as an investor, I know that like this is a playground for investors right now, because everything's going to be on sale. Those of us who have money or are sick and tired of the stocks and bonds and mutual funds, which I do not invest in, and are now ready for something new, this is an exciting time because there's all kinds of opportunity. So that's the biggest thing that I'm saying to people is, when you can get over that fear, stop listening to the noise out there and just sit down and get grounded, go for a walk in nature, connect with the people that you do have, and start to look at, what is the opportunity in front of me and how can I move from surviving to thriving?
Yeah, absolutely. So to touch on the news piece, I actually interviewed Dr. Sajjad Faisal last week. He is an Alberta specialist in the public health sector who does research on misinformation, especially around COVID. So, you know, what we spoke a lot about, the misinformation around the health piece, but again, it's all about the fear mongering that is going around, right? And so I would love to know from you, actually, on that note, you know, from a healthcare perspective, people can go to the Center of Disease Control, the World Health Organization. Where can people go that you believe is a really relevant evidence-based source for financial information outside of our government, of course?
Great question. So, you know, the kind of coaching that I do isn't necessarily about the, like, some of this stuff that you're talking about with the government programs and all that. Mm-hmm. However, through my network, I actually connected with a gentleman. He runs a business where he basically becomes your CFO, and then he does accounting and all this sort of stuff. And this guy has dedicated, he actually has a Facebook group about all of the government programs that are coming out. And his company makes a point of applying for everything, going through the process, and then being able to share that with the other people in the group. He's got connections to the people at the banks, like a bat phone to them to ask them questions. So that's what I've been doing, is if people are reaching out to me about that, I'm like, let me connect you to Bob. He's going to be your resource. Join the Facebook group. You're going to be getting updates. You're going to find out exactly what forms to fill out, how to do this, what it's going to look like, what you can expect for those people that are still in that, you know, that kookiness, trying to just make ends meet and cover their expenses. The other side of it, on the investment world, I mean, that one, it's a little tougher, right? That's a much bigger question. I mean, I'm always trying to provide people with information and that sort of thing. So I would say either any of your listeners here that are on this, they can reach out to me. If I can't answer the question for you, I can share resources that I'm checking into or people in my network that I'm up to. But the biggest thing, again, is like, just take all those news stories with a grain of salt. Understand that those people are running a business. They're trying to get eyes on their news stories, right? And the easiest way that they know to do that is fear and panic. And that is going to make people tune in to those. I mean, in one day I can read, you know, the economy is going to be up 20% and the economy is going to be down 40% in the same freaking day from different sources. And so a lot of it is just that. A lot of it is just noise. Going back to the healthcare for a second, I actually did one of these with a functional medicine doctor that's in my network. And we were talking about the fact that, ironically, fear and panic lowers your immune system.
100%.
Right? So talk about something that you shouldn't be doing, right? Mm-hmm. Like, this is where what you don't know will hurt you, in that sense of, if you're constantly in this fear cycle and worrying and panicking and freaking out, first of all, it doesn't do anything, right? Like,
absolutely.
Worrying about something doesn't make a difference. And second of all, you could be lowering your immune system and making yourself more susceptible to actually getting sick. So, I mean, this is why, for me, regular exercise, and so why I'm super pumped about being in your program. I do meditation every day. I do some writing every day. I'm connecting with friends for social activities. You know, you got to keep those other regular scheduled types of stuff going on and look after yourself.
100%. Let's get back to mindset for one second, right? So I often speak about mindset on this podcast, inside my online programs and my one-on-one clients, right? And, you know, mindset is the frame of which we see the world through, right? And even though there is a lot of uncertainty and overwhelm, like you said, it might not be in the context of overwhelm, but we need to flip that scarcity into a manageability around our finances, right? And I know that you believe that part of becoming and staying successful in business is knowing your finances, like we spoke about, and to kind of utilize those to reach your strategic goals, right? So what do our listeners need to know about how can we reframe our strategic goal during COVID? Right? And then what is the mindset that we need to kind of like mantra into us, right, as a day-to-day to get us through to the other side of the mindset game?
Great question again. You're really, you've done this once or twice, haven't
you?
Yeah,
a couple times.
So another exercise that I give my clients, and again, it never ceases to amaze me how like people are not present to their goals for the most part. So one of the exercises that I give people is, what is your 1 year, 3 year, and 5 year goals? Okay. And I want to be specific around these things, the SMART goals, if you will. Right. And here's the thing with those goals, is making them very vivid. So a lot of people will be like, well, I don't know how much I'm going to be making in 5 years. Great. Let's not worry about those types of details. But what kind of lifestyle do you want to be living? What kind of food do you want to be eating? Where do you want to be vacationing? What does your house look like and feel like? What does your relationship look like and feel like? Now, for most people, doing that 5 years out is tough. So start with like coming out of COVID-19. Okay? Yes. I actually just recently did this with one of the groups that I work with. I did 3 months from now, when we're coming out of this, what will my life look like? And then an end of the year, what will my life look like? And then a 3 year, what will my life look like? Mm-hmm. I have that written out. It's in detail. It's colorful. It involves smells and what I can see and what I can taste and what I can hear. And then I represent myself to that. And I look at it and I read it. And I try to feel the emotions around it. This is all around NLP also. I'm certified in neuro-linguistic programming.
Ah, very good. Yes.
You know, this sort of stuff gets involved in that and it plays a role in all this. But, you know, a lot of people, whether it be The Secret or manifesting or whatever, they're unclear about this. And what I've become clear on through, you know, work with Tony Robbins and other stuff is having a set of goals is great, but you got to feel that and be imagining it and believing that you're going to get it. Just on the weekend, I was doing some modules with a group and we talked about identify your goals and then go through them and be like, on a scale of 1 to 10, what's my belief that I can reach that goal? And what's my excitement level about that goal? And if those both aren't an 8 or above, then that goal is probably not really that important to you. You either need to reassess it or get rid of it. It's somebody else's goal that you know, you think you've been operating with, but maybe it's not all that important to you. Or it's too big and you need to chunk it down, right? Like, I want to be a millionaire. I'm scared. I don't believe I could do that. Well, let's start with an extra 100,000 in investing.
Right.
And you believe that? Yeah, I could do that. Great. Let's start there, right? And that's why the one-year goals, right? Don't get caught up in where I'm going to be 20 years from now. Where do I want to be 1 year from now? And then that's a daily or a weekly practice that you can do. You can take it with you and on a card and read it while you're walking through the woods and you know, in a positive place. And here's another thing. Right now, a lot of people are trapped at home complaining, right? Watching hours and hours and hours of Netflix.
Yep.
How about you educate yourself on something, right? Educate yourself on investing or finances or fitness or health or diets or whatever, right? Like, we have this golden opportunity in front of us right now. Even if it's 1 hour a day, if you did that for the next 30 days, you'd be 30 hours smarter about a particular topic than you are now. And then as we're coming out of this, you're going to be ready to start to take action around this rather than behind, you know, the people who did go out and become educated on stuff. So now's the time for courses and programs. And most practitioners and coaches like you and I are discounting our programs or offering bonuses, which, you know, I'm doing right now for people who want to learn about this stuff. So they're in a position to strike when the iron is hot when we come out of this situation.
Yeah, I absolutely love that. And we will link all the details to you, Brian, so that if people need support around that, whether it's education, having you as a course, being in your group programs, that they can access you for sure. But, you know, before we end, I wanted to touch on that. So I'm starting my Project You. It's a 5-week program starting today. And we speak about exactly this mindset around your goals. Is it obtainable? Is it sustainable? And does it excite you? Right?
Yes.
Because like you said, maybe you were living into somebody else's reality and desire that actually doesn't speak to you, right?
Yep.
And you said it so well. It is about the practice, the day in and day out, these many things. I mean, you hear me every morning when I'm screaming at y'all, right? Talking about this is it, showing up for yourself. It's the baby steps that we put in, those little things that you think, oh, it's not really going to make a difference, but it actually does in the long run.
Absolutely. And I mean, that's something that your listeners will be used to, right? You can't work out once a month or go have your health checkup twice a year and expect to see a difference and expect to see progress. The good news is with finances and investing, it doesn't have to be, you know, an hour every single day or 5 days a week. The awareness piece, I think that you should stay aware every day, but it could be, you know, sitting down and reviewing your finances once a month or, you know, checking into your investment goals once a quarter or something like that. But it is the practice. I say this all the time. What's the difference between me and somebody who's receiving the gold medal up on the podium? It's the daily practices that person does, right? That elevates them to where they want to be and helps them reach their goals. You have to have that goal to keep you focused. And then it's all of the practices you're doing to work towards it. And it can be fun. Here's a perspective shift for you. So when I was first getting into this, I was getting into real estate investing. And one of the first things was I was going to be moving into, you know, from my nice condo that, you know, I was living the lifestyle. And here I was going to be moving into a revenue property where I lived upstairs and had a basement suite. And it was like the prospect of moving and, oh God, and all that. And my business partner says to me, what if I told you I'd pay you $50,000 to move? Would you move then? I was like, yeah. He's like, well, that's the way to look at it then, right? You're going to go make $50,000 that the rest of these clowns sitting at their jobs are not going to make. So look at it like that. And after that, every time I'd sit down and do an expense report or cash checks or whatever, I'd be like, I'm paying myself to do this. Here's the money coming in. Here's me, you know, building towards it and seeing that progress. And now I love doing spreadsheets once a quarter because then I get to go to the bank and deposit a check after.
Yeah. 100%. It's all about mindset. I love that share. Thank you for sharing that. And thank you, Brian, for joining us today, sharing your wealth of knowledge on wealth, right?
Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you so much. You're welcome.